the world coming to? Have you been watching the news, reading the newspaper? There must be dozens of wars going on right now in the world. This year so far, I don't think even one day has gone by without at least two terror incidents somewhere. Just last night, a man in Brussels, Belgium, tried to ram a car into the police. Earlier this morning, another car bomb claimed more lives in Syria. There has been so much violence and mayhem, stealing parents from children, children from parents, spouse from spouse, friend from friend. We've watched in horror as kids wash up on beaches, as people get burned by bombs or chemical weapons. And in this and so much more, the guilty so often walk free. Even in Lancaster County, people may well settle arguments, not with a better argument, but with a bullet. I read in the paper just this morning about an assault here in Salisbury Township just this past week. It seems like theft, violence, and injustice always win the day. It seems like pain, sorrow, and death always have the upper hand. It seems like greed, exploitation, and media frenzy always follow in their wake. It seems like that's just the way the world is. Hopeless and cruel, it seems like we still aren't so far from the way Thomas Hobbes described the state of nature. When he described human life, that famous phrase, solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short. In light of that, what we read here in the prophecies of Ezekiel maybe doesn't sound so unfamiliar after all. Maybe this prophecy is not that out of place, all this talk of a vast army, their heavy equipment, the talk of an evil scheme to attack the innocent and carry away plunder, and the portrait of fire and blood. It's not a pretty picture. We all know it's not a pretty picture, but in light of the world we live in, it is a meaningful one. It starts like this. Son of man, set your face toward God of the land of Magog, the chief prince of Meshech and Tubal, and prophesy against him. Well, there are those familiar words, oh boy, Gog and Magog. They play a pretty prominent role in eschatology. And eschatology is a fancy word for the study of the end times, the study of the last things. If you've ever listened closely to an end times prophecy expert, you've heard plenty of talk about Gog and Magog since they show up in Revelation again after Ezekiel's prophecy. And that's one of the big questions those end times prophecy experts are often so sure about. The question, who's Gog? Where is Magog? What is this talking about? What's this going to look like? Throughout the years, experts have been very sure about a lot of different things. Some Christians in the 3rd century were certain that when Ezekiel and John said Gog and Magog, they meant the Roman Empire, because the Romans were dead set on persecuting Christians. Then in the 4th century, the Roman emperors started believing in Jesus, so maybe they're not Gog and Magog after all. Ah, but there are those heretic barbarians called the Goths. And so a 4th century bishop named Ambrose said, I bet the Goths are Gog and Magog. Now, the Goths sort of settled down. Fast forward few centuries, the empire is being challenged by a sweeping tide of Arabs propelled by a new religion called Islam. So you start to get a few people saying, those Arabs, that's God and they God. In the 13th century, barbarians from Northeast Asia start sweeping across the world, invading everything. And there's a Dominican missionary who says, those Mongols, they are the people of Magog. Even Marco Polo got on board with that trend. We fast forward a few more centuries, you get some more ideas. There's a guy named Joseph Meade who kicks off a big firestorm by suggesting Gog and Magog might be those notoriously evil lands known as the American colonies. That went over well. More popular was an idea put forth by Martin Luther that Gog, or at least Magog, refers to the Ottoman Empire, a great Muslim world power based in Turkey that ruled over the Holy Land. Up through the Revolutionary War, that was the most popular idea, that the Turks were the great Gog. A few decades pass, see the bloody and godless French Revolution, and a pastor in New England makes a case that the French Empire under Napoleon is Gog and Magog. A few more years pass, and there's the Crimean War in the 1850s, pits Russia against Britain, France, and the Turks, and now that Russia looks like a bad guy, somebody says, oh, the Russians are Gog and Magog. Crimean War ends. During the Civil War, one Methodist pastor thinks Europe is Gog, and after the Union wins, Europeans are going to attack America. That's what the prophecy is really about. World War I comes around, somebody says Gog, and that's the Germans. World Wars come and go, the Cold War begins, and a lot of people set their sights on Russia again. The Soviet Union, that's Gog and Magog. That's the idea most famously spread by Hal Lindsey in his book, The Late Great Planet Earth. Even Ronald Reagan got on board with the Soviet Union being Gog and Magog. Cold War ends, the Soviet Union falls, and you've got all these prophecy experts. And by the way, anytime you hear somebody call himself a prophecy expert, change the channel. Anyway, the prophecy experts are still really fixated on former Soviet powers. They downgrade Gog's importance, but Tim LaHaye, John Hagee in the 90s, they're still saying Ezekiel was talking about a Russian-Muslim alliance against Israel. These days, Joel Rosenberg says the same thing, focusing on Russia joining forces with Iran. In the past couple of years, we've started to see a new idea come out of the woodwork. Ron Cantor proposed that Gog and Magog is really talking about ISIS. That brings us up to today. What are we supposed to do with all that? Well, I'd like to suggest, with all due respect to these many centuries of misadventures in biblical interpretation, that they've pretty much all been missing the point of what Ezekiel's saying. Earlier in his book, Ezekiel has a set of seven major judgment messages against nations around Israel. Seven, the number of completeness in Hebrew. And now, at the climax of a sequence of prophecies about the blessing of God's people, there's one last judgment oracle, and it's against a mysterious chief prince from a people group who really haven't been mentioned at all since Genesis 10 at the Table of Nations. And what's more, if you count, Gog of Magog has seven military allies from Israel's north and south, distantly, but they're not the same as the other seven nations Ezekiel's already mentioned. Even though the language is borrowed from those messages, it starts to look like Gog of the land of Magog It is a symbol for something mysterious and vicious, a symbol summing up everything that was wrong with the evil empires Ezekiel called out earlier. That's what God is. He's a vivid image for evil's last best effort. He's a summary of human evil with a complete set of seven military allies and a complete set of seven merchant powers trying to cash in on his spoils and plunder. And they come from all the directions of the compass. This is all human evil wrapped up in one. In our world right now, we see a lot of different countries, different gangs, different terror groups, different factions, different people using violence and robbery to prey on the weak, to exert their power, to augment their prestige and privilege. Gog is all that added up, projected on the big screen. Gog is what they all aspire to be. Gog is their hero. Gog is their idol. Gog is the summary of human evil, the summary of oppression and injustice, the summary of what it means for the world to be given over to sin. It doesn't matter what mask he wears. Maybe it's the mask of red tape, mask of terrorism, the mask of gang warfare, the mask of identity politics, the mask of nationalism or internationalism or any other mask. Ezekiel is unmasking him for what he really is, the him to which all of history's violence points. And one day, Ezekiel says, that full fury gets unleashed in the direction of God's people, but only by God's permission. When we look at Gog and Magog and all their hosts, when we eavesdrop on their plans, we aren't seeing one nation or another nation. We're not seeing and hearing just the Romans, just the Goths, the Arabs, the Mongols, the Turks, the Germans, the Russians, the terrorists. We're seeing the exposure of something that's everywhere, even here. Because this is how evil operates even now. The strong, the greedy, and the envious use death and pain as a weapon to silence anyone who resists them. A weapon to take what's not theirs, to gain more power, more wealth, to impose their vision on an unwilling world. We saw it in Castro's Cuba. You saw it in Soviet Russia. You saw it in the Third Reich and in Mussolini's Italy. You saw it in the streets. You still see it in the streets of Chicago. You see it in the Middle East. You see it all around you, and sometimes in you. Past few months in our own county have seen multiple murders, people using death as a weapon to settle an argument, to settle a score. Families from our own church have been plundered of their belongings, as we heard this morning. Families from our own church have been exposed to the powerful pain of death, and all that leads up to God. So many powers in our world use this pain of death and this fear of loss as a way to control others. And they wish that they could be like God. One day they may just get their wish. And if that were all there were to the story, it wouldn't be a pretty story. That's not a happy story. If all human history leads to Gog, and if Gog stands triumphant over his enemies, just like violence seems to stand triumphant over the world today, well, where would that leave us? If that's all there is to the story, then it looks like death and violence work. People can be silenced. People can be crushed and destroyed. Millions upon millions have lost their lives and their dignity in the hands of Gog's many precursors. Millions upon millions have been turned into mere statistics. statistics and covered up in the sands of time, and if Gog is where it's all headed, what's the point of anything else? What's the point if history is nothing but a revolving door of oppressors, tyrants, and revolutions? The violence of the world would go unchecked because the violence of the world is the real winner on the world stage. Beneath all the civilized veneer we try to use like a mask over God's face, there God is. It really is the law of the jungle out there. Nothing but nature red in tooth and claw. Nothing but might making right, or at least might making right irrelevant. God is on the right side of history, as they say. At least, if that's all there is to the story. But that's not all there is to the story. See, the story continues. The story continues because Jesus Christ is risen, amen. And because Jesus Christ is risen, God can never have the last word. Gog can never finally destroy. Death and violence may be the strongest weapon in Gog's arsenal. But Jesus has the veto power over the death penalty even after it's been carried out. And so for all those whom Gog or his precursors execute, for all those whom they gun down in the streets, all those whom they love, all those they burn away, all those whose property or heritage they steal and violate like their father, the devil who came only to kill and destroy. For all those who want to look like God. There's an end. But for all those who suffer, the story is not over. Their story may just continue long after God's story has reached its conclusion. And for those who follow Jesus, that's not just a possibility, that is a guarantee. And so the prophet Ezekiel makes a few things very clear for us. First, God and Gog do not see eye to eye. In fact, when Gog exposed himself once and for all, so does God's wrath against our wrathful lives. God's judgment on human violence and greed and injustice is laid bare here in terms few other prophets equal. The Lord said, "My wrath will be roused in my anger, for in my zeal and my blazing wrath I declare, I will summon a sword against God on all mountains. Every man's sword will be against his brother. With pestilence and bloodshed I will enter into judgment with him. I will rain upon him and his hordes and the many peoples who are with him, torrential rains and hailstones, fire and sulfur. So I will show my greatness and my holiness and make myself known in the eyes of many nations. Then they will know that I am the Lord." John, writing in Revelation, is no less clear. "I saw the beast and the kings of the earth with their armies gathered to make war against Christ, who was sitting on the horse, and against his army. And the beast was captured, and with it the false prophet who in his presence had done the signs by which he deceived those who had received the mark of the beast and those who worshipped his image. These two were thrown alive into the lake of fire that burns with sulfur, and the rest were slain by the sword that came from the mouth of him who was sitting on the horse. And when the devil comes out to deceive the nations in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them for battle, they marched up over the broad plain of the earth and surrounded the camp of the saints in the beloved city, but fire came down from heaven and consumed them. And the devil who had deceived them was thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur, where the beast and the false prophet were, and they would be tormented day and night, forever and ever." That's a graphic description. what it shows is this. God and those like God do not get the last word. Gog does not have the final victory. Gog and his precursors may stride the world stage for a time, playing a role, imagining they write the script, but they do not. When we suffer at their hands, when we're oppressed, when we're opposed by governments, when we're threatened by terrorists, we fear for safety in our own streets or our own homes, when we don't know what to do or where to turn, whenever we suffer, whenever we grieve, God is not watching this with mere indifference. When we cry out in His name for deliverance, God is not ignoring us. God is allowing this for His purposes, but He will turn our sufferings into glory and God's glory into sufferings unto destruction. If people imagine that violence will get them anywhere, it means they're short-sighted. Whenever people imagine that the battle goeth to the strong or the race to the swift, it's because they're short-sighted. When people imagine that violence and theft are forever a part of the world, that's short-sighted. And whenever people imagine it doesn't matter what you believe or how you live, that's short-sighted. Because the scriptures say the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. God is not ignoring that. Ezekiel wants to know that very clearly. God does not win. Violence does not win. Unjust judges do not win. Terrorists do not win. Labor camps. Gulags. Gas chambers, firing squads, bombs, and bullets, and knives do not win. The killers and thieves of the world, the bureaucrats and thugs who aid and abet them, the spiritual darkness, the powers of the political and economic powers who use them to their own advantage, they don't win. In the end, they will lose. They will lose. They will lose when they find that in preying on the peaceful, they're picking a fight with fire from heaven. And all we need to do is decide in how we live whether we're going to be on God's side, the right side of history, or on God's side, the right side of eschatology. God does not win. God wins. But Ezekiel has more to tell us. Chapter 38 is about the defeat of God. Chapter 39 is about the disposal of God. And there are three major themes here. First, God does not get preserved in a fancy mausoleum like Vladimir Lenin, on display to be oohed and awed at by adoring generations in perpetuity. Ezekiel says, all the people of the land will bury them. God also tells Ezekiel to prophesy to the birds and the beasts, calling them to come to the dinner God has set out for them, to eat the flesh of the mighty and drink the blood of the prince of the earth. John used a lot of the same language. I saw an angel standing in the sun, and with a loud voice, he called all the birds that fly directly overhead, come, gather for the great supper of God, to eat the flesh of kings, the flesh of captains, the flesh of mighty men, the flesh of horses and their riders, the flesh of all men, both small and great, and all the birds were gorged their flesh. It's a gruesome image because it's not exactly an honorable burial. All the strength of God, all the force of evil, all the power of violence not only does it die away, but it dies in disgrace. Evil does not get to make a name for itself. Violence and theft do not accomplish glory. Throws it away. Then Ezekiel goes on to say, those who dwell in the cities of Israel will go out and make fires out of the weapons and burn them. Shields and bucklers, bow and arrow, club and spear, and they'll make fires out of them for 7 years, so that they will not need to take wood out of the field or cut down any of the forests, for they'll make their fires out of their weapons. They'll seize the spoil of those who spoiled them and plunder those who plundered them. What's that mean? Well, in other words, evil can do its worst to us. It can steal from us. It can hurt us. It can even kill our bodies for a while. But when everything is said and done, God works all things together for good to those who love Him, who are called according to His purpose. What they mean for evil against us, God means as good for us. If you've been stolen, if you've ever been injured, if you've been cheated, if you've been denied justice, if you've been betrayed, if you've lost loved ones, and if you belong to Jesus, He's going to turn that to your benefit. He will give you the plunder from those who plundered you. And every weapon that was schemed and designed and employed to hurt you will end up fueling your life in the world to come. The meek shall inherit the earth. God will. Finally, Ezekiel says, the land will be cleansed after the battle. For 7 months, the house of Israel will be burying them in order to cleanse the land. They'll set men apart to travel through the land regularly and bury those travelers remaining on the face of the land so as to cleanse it. And at the end of 7 months, they'll make their search. When they travel through the land and anybody sees a human bone, then they'll set up a sign by it until the buriers have buried it in the valley of Hamon Gog. Thus shall they cleanse the land. I think that's what Isaiah meant when God told him, behold, I create a new heaven and a new earth, and the former things shall not be remembered or come to mind. I think it's what John means when he writes, the first heaven and the first earth have passed away, and God will wipe away every tear from His people's eyes, and death shall be no more, neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. In other words, not only is Gog defeated, not only is Gog disgraced, not only does Gog's evil turn into benefit for God's people, but in the very end, Gog won't even be a memory. Nobody will still be haunted or traumatized by him or by his precursors. There will be no PTSD. There will be no fear. There will be no anxiety. There will be no need to remember God, to remember any violence, to remember any of the days of evil. The traces and the effects will all be buried. That's what Ezekiel is telling us. Brothers and sisters, we look at the world around us. We watch or we read the news and we see plenty of real violence. We see plenty of evil. Sometimes it's in faraway lands, but sometimes it comes near. Sometimes it steals from us. It hurts us. It does injustice to us, it taints our lives with death and loss. Some of you know that firsthand this morning from recent experience over the past year. And in that time, we cry out the words of the psalmist, "How long, O Lord, will you look on? Rescue me from their destruction." We pray that prayer, and the next day we get up and we have to pray that prayer again, and we wonder if it will ever end, and we wonder if all this around us could ever be made right or could ever be fixed. We wonder if God and all the aspiring mini-gods all over the earth will always have the upper hand. If we will always be caught in the middle or under their thumb. And every indication from the world around us whispers, yes. The word of God thunders, no. Because Christ is risen. And because Christ is risen to endless days, God's days are numbered with a very definite end. Violence has an expiration date. Evil will be vanquished, and you will see a day when you turn on the TV or pick up a newspaper and there's nothing but good news, because the good news will win. So no matter how things look in this world around us, no matter how things look in our country, no matter how terrible our gods, precursors, and minions, no matter how bad the harm they leave in their wake, no matter how dark things seem to get, Gog is not forever. Tragedy is not forever. Injustice is not forever. Violence is not forever. Terror is not forever. Pain is not forever. And death is not forever. These things are, none of them, eternal. They will fail. Destruction will be destroyed. They will be disgraced. They will be discarded from life and from mind. Even if now God can kill your body, take your freedom, your property, your dignity, even if God comes at you and does his worst, it's only temporary. You will outlive God so long as you follow the rider who is faithful and true, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the Prince of Peace who died and is alive forevermore. So take heart. Hallelujah. The ways and days of God are numbered, but we're with Jesus to endless days. And Jesus is forever. Thanks be to God. Father and God, we labor in this world in the midst of violence, injustice, and pain. We see the effects of fall daily, but we know that its days are numbered. By faith, we look beyond human history as we've known it, or the present as we behold it. We look forward by faith to the day the faithful and true one returns and does away with evil forever, so that all former things will pass away, come to mind no more. O Lord, haste the day. Come, Lord Jesus. Maranatha. Hallelujah.